Hey, Macheroni. This is a Venda language. And it has to be learned like any other language. Because it's very, very important. Our president is a Venda. So you don't have any choice at all. You have to learn it, whether you like it or not. Otherwise, good afternoon. Thanks once more, Prof Machaba, for giving us an opportunity to present to our lovely students. Thank you very much. I really appreciate what has been actually presented by my colleagues. I have learned a lot from you about those verbs. I've been requested to talk about mathematical verbs by Prof Machaba. As if there are mathematics verbs. But I would love to differ to say all those verbs that have been actually discussed are also used in mathematics, all of them. Maybe it could differ in terms of the text embedded on those verbs, which is mathematical language. And I have decided to be unique, to differ a little bit with my colleagues, because they presented about verbs, but mine will be more on integrated with some of the activities, and it will be mathematical activities for that matter. I want to start off with this, that as much as you're preparing for your examination, we want you to pass. That's a fact. But we don't just be interested in your passing, because you can actually get a distinction not knowing a thing. Somebody might say, is that possible? Yes, it's possible. You can actually get it through memorization. You get a decision through memorization. Now, there are a lot of things that are actually happening during this time whereby learners are camping. You know what they're doing there? Have you been there? They're drilling. They've been drilled actually to answer question papers. And I'm asking myself, after being trained, yes, we'll pass, then what? What next? And then we get a situation whereby sometimes we get these students or distinctions, and when they come to the university, we have a situation whereby they cannot budge at all. And you ask yourself, what is the problem? What is the problem here? It's because they've been drilled to pass. Because everything was exam-orientated. It's like in our government, it's too much exam-orientated. That really sometimes it makes me to be angry. Why are we learning? Are we learning to pass? Or are we learning to understand something? Yeah. And that is the angle in which I'm coming from. What does it mean to know and to do mathematics? Although in my talk I will be focusing much more on mathematics, but you can replace the word mathematics by geography or history. Yeah. It's up to you then. Because some of the things that I will be talking about will be very much integrated to some other learning areas. Mathematics is very much an interesting subject because I regard it as a science of pattern and order. So, Prof. Machaba, when you see something in a pattern form, that is mathematics. When you see something in an orderly form, that is mathematics. You see, we are seated here in an orderly form. I can come up with some mathematical conjectures or the mathematical concept based on our sittings. When somebody is dancing, and it is in his dancing, or like dancing, there's some pattern. You can come up with a mathematical conjectures or the concept today. So mathematics is everything. So if you're not doing mathematics, you don't have to worry today, because you are going to learn it. And all of you are going to pass if you're gonna be given a mathematics question paper, because it's very simple and straightforward. I have decided firstly to talk about a kind of a framework being developed by some scholars, I call them academics. They call it a strength of mathematical proficiency. In the place of mathematics, you can put your own subject. What does it mean to learn mathematics or to study mathematics successfully, proficiently, with and competent? And let's talk about some kind of five strengths that will yield to that competency or learning mathematics successfully. And they argue that, that's Kilpatrick together with his colleagues, they argue that these strengths are connected. In other words, are interwoven. They are interdependent. You cannot actually learn the other and leave the other one. They are just, as you see, as you see on the that picture, the interwovenness. So it's time. What do you call that hairstyle, by the way?
Cornrows. It's my
hairstyle. Oh, yes, hairstyle. Can you stand up and see that interwovenness? Thank you very much. I'm talking about that interwovenness. So in that particular interwovenness, according to Kilpatrick together with his colleague, they said, in order for you actually to understand mathematics or geography, whatever, there's a strand or a component in which they call it a conceptual understanding. What does it mean, or what is a conceptual understanding? A conceptual understanding is the comprehension of mathematical concepts, or geographical concepts, or English concepts. In the context of mathematics, it is a comprehension of mathematical concepts together with its operations. By operations, I mean when you talk about addition. What is the meaning of addition? Addition, you cannot say addition is addition. That's not a definition of addition. But when you add, what do you actually do? See, mathematics is about doing. And I'm talking about the doing verbs here. When you add, what are you actually doing? You are combining things, isn't it? Multiplication. What do you mean by multiplication? What do you mean by division? What do you mean by subtraction? So those are mathematical concepts which are a little bit abstract. But you need to concretize them with your own language. And you need to define them in such a way that you will be able to understand. So you come across a mathematical concept as in when you are answering your mathematical question paper. Although we may not actually say, define fraction as a mathematical concept, but I think you need to know that a fraction is a part of a whole. And what does it mean when you say it's a part of a whole? That numerator on top and that denominator, what is the meaning of? If it's 3/4, what is the meaning of that 3/4? Is that the meaning my whole is being divided into equal parts? Or my whole has been divided into 4 equal parts, and 3 of those parts have been identified. That is the meaning of 3/4. And we have a conceptual understanding of that particular representation of a fraction. So in other words, in order for you to understand the concept, you need to also to understand once more its representations. Conceptual understanding, it also talks about the connection. The connections between mathematical concepts. I'm going to give some examples as time goes on here. Because my belief is that you cannot learn mathematical concepts in isolation. You will understand as we go on that multiplication can be used with addition for you to understand whatever mathematical problem that you are dealing with. You cannot learn fractions without decimal fractions. You need to borrow from some other concept in order for you to understand that concept that you are learning. No mathematical concept is in isolation, but they are connections. They are connectivity. They are integrated. And I believe that it might not be in mathematics only, but in some other languages. In order for you to learn that concept in your learning area, there are some other concepts that actually give it to life. Another connection, once more, is about the connection between mathematical concepts with everyday life context. Mathematical in itself, we regard it as being so abstract. But that's how we have been taught. You see, that sometimes the way we have been taught is not good. We need to be retaught. I think you need to go back and claim your school fees sometimes to say, I've never been taught properly. Because I never been taught conceptually, but we have been taught sometimes one of the strengths that have been alluded by Kilpatrick's strengths. I mean, Kilpatrick, together with his colleagues, about strengths of mathematical proficiency, is we call it procedural fluency. And what do we mean by procedural fluency? Procedural fluency just means some skills of carrying procedures flexibly, effectively, and appropriately. So in mathematics, sometimes you will be required actually to write step by step. So step by step, that is procedure, all right? But that is very dangerous sometimes, because you can do that without a conceptual understanding, and you call it algorithm. In other words, you memorize the procedures without the understanding of the concept. That is very, very dangerous. And that's basically how our education system actually, they emphasize a lot of this, as in when they teach a lot of this strategy, which is procedural fluency without conceptual understanding. You are going to be a teacher, student teachers. We want you to teach not the way sometimes you've been taught, but teach with an understanding of what you're doing, of understanding of the concept. And one of the strengths, the third strength, they call it a strategic competency. What is a strategic competency? A strategic competency is a strategy in mathematics, we used to call it a problem solving. That is why sometimes you need to formulate the problem. You need to let your learners to formulate the problem and to represent the problem in a mathematical language, coming from a contextualized whatever language, and into a mathematical language, because mathematics is a language. It has its own syntax, grammars, and everything. So that's basically why you are in the ability to formulate, to represent, and to solve for X problem. That is the strategy. So sometimes you will come across in a question paper problems that will be requiring you to think a little bit, what is the problem here? And I'm going to give an example. What is the problem here? And how can I convert this particular problem into a mathematical problem or a mathematical language? And then how can then I solve it? The fourth component or strength is what you call it, an adaptive reasoning. Metacognitive level. You give a justification or an explanation of what you are doing. You justify each and every step that you are writing. Why am I actually writing this? Why am I giving this response? Why am I saying 2 plus 3 is equal to 5? Why? If I'm asking you that question, why? You cannot just say, because I've been told that 2 plus 3 is equal to 5. I need a little bit more on that. You can talk about, you can try to analyze, as Dr. Ferreira is saying, that 2 has been made of 2 ones, and we've got 3 ones, and whenever I add them, they give me 5 ones. Then they are giving me some kind of justification that I want. So whenever you reach these particular strengths, we need more of justification, more of explanation of whatever that you are doing. Metacognition, the reason, whatever that you are doing, give some kind of a reasoning behind it. It could be inductively reasoning or deductively reasoning. And in mathematics, we use both reasoning to say, I want to justify actually my assumption, my statement. If I'm actually saying, if I add, for an example, two odd numbers, can you add two odd numbers there? I think you've been in sub A. If you've been in sub A, you know odd numbers. Can you just add two odd numbers? I'm giving you a homework and instruction. Add two odd numbers.
3 plus 5.
Okay. Okay, can you get another one again? Just get three of them and just add them and then give me some conjecture that you come up with there. Okay? So you will realize that whenever you add any odd number or you subtract any odd number, it gives you what? If you add any two odd numbers, they give you an even number, isn't it? That's the conjecture that you can come up with. You've never been taught that, but you investigate, you explore that, and you will never forget whatever that you've investigated and you've explored. Never! Whether you are in an exam, raining or not raining, but you'll never forget that, because you never memorize that. Alright? So that is basically some adaptive reasoning. The last one is what we call it a productive disposition. What is a productive disposition? According to Kirkpatrick et al., they are arguing that for you to have a productive disposition, you need to have all these four strengths. You need to be having conceptual understanding, procedural fluency, strategic competence, and adaptive reasoning. It's then that you have a productive disposition. What is a productive disposition? It's an habitual inclination to see that this thing called mathematics makes sense. It's sensible. It's worthwhile. It can be used, this thing called mathematics. It is not just computation. It's not just to add things and to manipulate numbers. But this thing called mathematics, it does make sense. It's only when you have all these four, then you will have an habitual inclination, a tendency to see some sense in mathematics. You develop what you call a mathematical identity. Whatever you see, whatever you speak mathematics. Because now you shall be having a positive attitude towards mathematics. That is the science whereby you'll be having a positive attitude towards mathematics. You will love mathematics. You'll say, I love this thing called mathematics. You will never love mathematics if you never learn mathematics conceptually. If you never learn mathematics with a procedural fluency, strategic competence, and adaptive reasoning, you will hate it. You will have a negative attitude towards mathematics because you shall have not developed all these traits that I'm talking about. Mathematics is very simple. Mathematics is very lovable. Mathematics is very enjoyable. I believe that, Prof. Machaba, everyone can do mathematics, depending on who taught you, who teach you, who's teaching you. You must come to me and I teach you so that we develop productive disposition. Now, all these trends, as I've already indicated, they are interwoven, they are integrated. I just have some examples there. I don't want to dwell much on this because my colleagues have already. Some of the verbs in mathematics that we use is to explore, investigate, conjecture, as we came up with some conjectures there, to discover. For an example, I just give some example there of some A example. What do you notice? What is the pattern? What is the relationship of those numbers? Are they there? Yes. What do you see there? Everybody can answer those things, whether you are mathematicians. You see, the reason why you don't answer this is because you've got a negative attitude towards the mathematics. You don't even want to look at it. Okay? But what is the operation? Whenever you add them, what is happening? Huh? You get the same number. Huh? When you add them. But why? So you play about some patterns. There's a pattern there which is emanating. Can you see that? What is the pattern? Can I ask mathematicians over here?
Odd and even.
Okay, somebody says odd and even.
The even numbers are decreasing when they decrease.
Woo! That's great. Oh, that's a good observation. So you can see that there's an up and down, up and down, up and down. The other one is increasing, the other one is increasing. So that's an observation that whenever you take any number, it's going just to be like that. You're going to get the product of which is the same. That's an observation that you want in mathematics. So you investigate it, you come with an object for that. Learning mathematics. So that, this one I've already indicated. When two odd numbers are multiplied, what you get, subtracted, what you get, when you add them, what you get. That you do at home. Okay, I'm going to give you some activity 5 which might cater the concept or the verbs, verify, solve, and predict. But I want us to have a look at the next one. What strategies would you use to find the sum? And you have to explain the strategies. Find the sum of 199 plus 47 quickly, without even going to write something. A paper and pencil, you don't have to write, but just see some logic there that you can make use of. We talked about some relationships. What are some relationships that you can make use of them? Anyone who didn't do mathematics? I need those who are not mathematicians just to get that quickly. Anyone? Yes? Why? You add what? Sorry?
You add the number 199 plus 47 and you get the sum.
But how did you get it? How did you get it? That's my question.
Okay, I use the horizontal.
Okay, so you use what you call algorithm.
Yes.
And that's what basically I'm kind of trying to be against it. There's something that you can use very quickly then. So what about if I add 200 plus 47? It's easy to add 200, isn't it? Just convert that 199 to be 200. Plus 47 is what? 247. And then you subtract the one that you've added. Is what? 246. You don't have to crack the head. All right? So that's basically what you call the relationship. You see, the only language that learners know, I'm not talking about you, I'm talking about language. Learners who are at school, not you. When you talk about the relationship, they think about girls and boys. That's the only thing that they know. But I'm talking about the relationship between numbers. Okay? There are some relationships here. All right? So you can also do the same with the next one. Okay? I'm not sure if I have to come to this one. No? Yes. Activity 1. Very interesting activity. I want to give you a second just to think about it. It reads, 4 children had 3 boxes of Smarties. They decided to open all 3 boxes to share the Smarties fairly. There were 52 Smarties in each box. How many Smarties did each child get? I know that you can do that example, isn't it? Very quickly also. You can make use of procedures, fluency, you can use calculators, you can do it. But I don't want to go that route today. I've chosen to have a look at 2 learners' responses. The one who tried actually to have a look at that particular problem and try to answer it. And those learners are Michael and Ronnie. Now, the question that basically we can give you as student teachers, we can say, now look at 2 attempts from grade 4 learners to solve this problem. We will never actually ask you to solve that problem because we know that we're going to solve it, isn't it? But we say, look at the attempts of these 2 grade 4 learners, how they've done it. Explain, the word explain there, in your own words, how the 2 learners solve the problem. This is basic mathematics, I just want to think up. Just look at it. and then try to see how these learners have done. Those come up with these solutions, strategies. Let's start with Michael. Anyone who think what Michael did there?
Edit the smarties in all the boxes.
Okay, that's the first thing that Michael did. Michael actually realized that there are 3 boxes, all right? And then in each box, there are 52 smarties. But you cannot do that if you don't read. You will have to read with an understanding, okay? So you need to read that particular contextualized mathematics problem. It is contextualized because it has been connected to learners' everyday life experiences. Learners can find themselves in that particular problem. That's basically what Michael did. So he multiplied, actually, 3 boxes multiplied by 52, or maybe might have added whatever, okay? To get what? 156. So you see 156 there? What happened there?
Divided by
4 lines. So he understood that actually the question is about division. Alright? But I like the way Michael actually did it. Alright? So let's have a look at what his strategy. Where does 10 come from and 40 there? What Michael did, it may not actually make sense to you. So what does it mean as a student teacher? Sometimes you need basically, as in when you teach, we're not just teaching you for exam here. When you teach, you need to get into learners' thinking. And then how can you get into learners' thinking if you don't talk to them? If you don't communicate in a classroom situation? Your class is always quiet because it's a mathematics class. It must not be a noisy class. Mathematics class must be a noisy class. So you cannot actually know what Michael did there unless actually you call Michael to explain his strategy. Okay? Maybe just to get into Michael's head, what Michael did, he realized that it's a division method. So he gave 10 smarties to each of those 4 children. Okay? And then what's left is 40. So he subtracted. Alright? What is left is 40. And then from there, oh no, it's not 40. It only gave 10 to 4 of them, which is 40. Do you understand where does 40 come from? Do you understand where does 10 come from?
Yes.
All right? And then what is left there is 116 smarties. After 116 smarties, he gave them 4 again. All right? And what is left is 100. And then after that, he gave them 25. And then he add 25 plus 10 plus 4, 39 each. What Michael did never been taught by a teacher. That's what we call it a strategic competence. It's when you apply your thinking to a non-routine mathematical problem. Your strategy is a non-routine because it's not what the teacher taught you in class. The teacher, I guess, should have taught, maybe could have taught what you call a long division method.
Yeah.
Do you know long division method?
Yeah.
I never understood a long division method until I came to UNISA. I understood a long division method being a professor.
Seriously.
A long division method. I'm not talking about the computation of law. That one I can do very fast. But just to understand where does long division method come from? I knew here. Composer must be a social serial. I have to go and demand it. Seriously. So, this is Michael. What about Ronnie? I think Ronnie's strategy is very, I think it can be understood by everyone. Very interesting. Ronnie realized that he had 4 children. Okay? But he realized also that he had 156 smarties. Because he wrote the smarties there, 156 is there. But he gave them 20.
Yeah,
I think you have a mathematician.
No, I
don't. So he gave each 20, and thereafter?
5.
Thereafter?
10.
Thereafter? 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. What is it that Ronnie was doing? Sharing.
Equally.
Sharing equally. Very good. Sharing. Mathematical concept. But whenever you share, everybody can understand what you share mean. Alright? So you take this into an everyday life experiences. So these are some of the learner solution strategies. I don't know if I'm still having time, but I want to have a look at this one. Consider the subtraction using the vertical algorithm which the learner did and answer the question. What was happening here? The learner actually was given this particular problem, 603, subtract 257. And the learner said, 3 minus 7. That's what they wrote. You can read there.
There is
nothing. Okay, there is. So he wanted actually to go, he used the procedure of what? Borrowing. Next door. You borrow next door. That's what I was taught. You borrow next door. And he realized, you bought salt next door. And he realized that the next door doesn't have salt.
Yeah.
So he bought another next door again. All right? And then he borrowed what? One. And remained with what? But Ronnie realized, no, man, I cannot put two because there's nothing. And then I put one there to be 13. And then he said 13 minus 7 is 6. And the question that we are asking you now, student teachers, we are saying, what calculation error did the learner make in this subtraction? So we have already given your mark to say the learner did some mistakes there, isn't it? What errors? What conceptual error did the learner make? We also give you some hint to say, think about some mathematical concept. All right, what is the problem here? The problem is the lack of conceptual understanding. You teach too much of algorithm. You teach too much of procedures without understanding the concept. And what kind of concept is the key here? You may not know, but let me tell you because I'm mathematicians. The concept here, what you should be knowing was that concept you studied in some, I think it's grade 3, if not mistaken. The concept of a place value. Have you ever heard about something like that? A place value. What does it mean, a place value? So you have to ask yourself, what does it mean, this name of the thing, when the chess is a place value? And that is what this learner had a problem with, a place value. He borrowed 1 from 6. He realized that that's 6. Was that 6 really? It's not 6, isn't it? That is 600. That is 600. Okay? Yeah, it's not. And the one there, that is not even one. Is what? It's 100. So you can only understand that language when you tell yourself, what is this concept all about? What is this concept all about? Try to figure it out before you could manipulate, before you could come up with those procedures. When you do them without even understanding them. Okay. So the general thing here is because the concept of place value is not there. Because how Ronnie was taught. Okay, we don't blame Ronnie, but how Ronnie was taught. What about this one? Simple has a piece of a string that is exactly 2 meters long. He wants to divide it equally among 3 friends. What part of the string will each one get? Okay? This problem is about what? Fractions. You can see the word fraction there. But it's for you actually as when you read it to say, okay, I've been given a number line. In terms of 0 to 1, in terms of 1 to 2, obviously that will be also be emphasized with whatever that has been given unto you in terms of the problem there. When you try to analyze that particular problem, there is a 2 meter long and it has to be divided into 3 among 3 friends. What? How are you going to do it? So the concept of fraction here is also come into the picture, the conceptual understanding of a fraction. What is a fraction? Okay? It's a part of a whole. My whole one needs to be divided into equal parts. And in this context, obviously, it must be into 3 equal parts because I've got 3 friends there. Okay? So if you take your whole as being 0 to 1, it's a whole. From 1 to 2, it's also a whole. Alright? So I can say okay, I can actually, what particular fraction I can use here, which will be dividing from 0 to 1. Alright? So it must be 1/3, 1/3, and 1/3. In other words, from 0 to 1, I must just keep 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. I'm done with that. From 1 to 2, I'm also going to keep 1/3, 1/3, 1/3. And each is going to receive what? 2/3. Alright? Those who are doing mathematics, they should be knowing all of this what I'm talking about. But even those who are not doing it, but the way I'm explaining it. Very interesting one is this one. Analyze the learner response below and identify the possible misconceptions that this learner is experiencing. Provide remedial action that you think will assist the learner, the teacher or the learner. We ask you, student teacher, we cannot ask you to solve this problem. No way. Because we know that you are going to be teacher. You are going to represent us very well. Alright? We are going to come across problems of this nature whereby learners have been solving them. So how then are you analyzing them? This is the problem. And this is what the learner did. What happened here?
One of half, one of
yes.
Three, and then got five.
Oh.
He said it's 22.
Okay, he said it's 22. That's exactly what the learner did. Alright?
Sure.
And this is wrong, isn't it?
Yeah.
But do you really sometimes try to figure it out to say, why is the learner doing something like this? Yeah. And we call this some kind of misconceptions. What is a misconception? You missed the concept. And what concept is this here? The concept of fraction. But one thing that I like, you see, when learners come up with something of this nature in my class, I like it.
They're thinking.
It shows that somebody's thinking. Misconception is a part of learning. When you are learning in the class, come up with some wrong answer, don't beat them. Don't discard those wrong answers. Welcome them. Try to access their thinking behind those responses. And you can actually see that the learner here was drawing from another domain of mathematics to use it to another domain of mathematics which was not supposed to be used to. And that you can actually see it's a misconception if you draw from another domain. And the domain in which the learner drew from is the domain of whole numbers. How to add whole numbers, we add them like that. But the learner could understand that, no, this is not whole numbers, this is a fraction. Okay. Very easy, if you understand the fraction, you don't even have to do pencil and paper algorithm. To get some LCD, if you know some LCD. I don't like LCDs and whatever this is. And whatever denominators. But you can just see that, you can contextualize this problem. I'm just thinking about now. Firstly, you can add the whole number, 7 and 10, 17. All right? But you can also, the fractions there, which are there, is what and what? Half and half. Aren't you able to add half and half? Half a bread plus half a bread is what? It's one. And what about half of 1 + 3/4 of bread? Can't you add that one? You can add. And then you add plus leave that percentage that you got. So this in itself, it makes life easier if you understand the concept. It's about conceptual understanding. Without looking at whether you have to multiply 2, multiply by 7, plus 1, get whatever. And whatever, or you take out the LCD, but think. I'm not suggesting those who are mathematics here. I'm not suggesting that whenever you do your procedure is wrong. No. But I'm saying your procedures, your algorithm, whatever that you're doing, which is too procedural, it must be accompanied by conceptual understanding. That's what I'm saying. There must be some kind of strategic competency. And there must be some kind of adaptive reasoning, some justification behind your responses, or learners' responses. Good. Can I finish? Can I end up here? What do you call this? Donuts? number of donuts and cost in rent to produce them. Mathematics is about pattern. Mathematics is about science of order. Now, if you can actually see that number of donuts is 1, 2, 3, blah, 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 and the cost, what does it mean? It means 1, what do you call them, donuts or donuts, whatever. Yeah. 1 cost what? 3 rents. 2, 5, 9, 3. Yes, so what is the relationship? 3, 5, and 7. So you can see that the relationship there is the common of 2. Alright? Now, but normally whenever we ask that kind of question, we will say complete whatever. We can say complete number 4 or, and 5 and 6 on the corresponding block there. And then we ask you a general question to say, how much will 100 donuts cost? So you cannot actually go to 100 whenever you're doing like that. Moving by 2, 2, 2, 2, 2. Where will you reach 100? Until Jesus Christ comes, eh? But mathematics is about generalization. To make life easier. Just to make your life very easier, we say come up with some generalized statement after the pattern being used. So the pattern that can be generalized here is, how did I come up with 3 there? The first term, which is 3, is 2 multiplied by 1 plus 1 is equal to 3, isn't it? I got that 3. The second term is 2 multiplied by, I don't have that thing here, but I can use this one. Okay, so this 2, can you see my, you can't see,
no,
what I'm doing here. But you can actually see what I'm explaining. It's 2 multiplied by 2, the 2 on top, the 2 on the number of donuts, plus 1 is equal to 5. You see what that 5? And 3, 2 multiplied by 3 plus 1 is 7. So do you see the pattern? Do you see the sequence? Now can you come up with some general statement? The general statement is T multiplied by 2 is there already. But you can see the numbers that vary. It's 1, 2, 3. Can you see them? Those numbers, we represent them by a variable. Any variable, it can be X, it can be N, it can be K. That is why we call them variable, because it varies. Okay? Plus 1. So your general statement is 2N plus 1. That you can use to get the number of, the cost in rents to produce whatever. Number of dollars. You can use that one. If you want 100, you just say 2 multiplied by 100 plus 1, you get the number. If you want 200, it's 2 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 200 plus 1, you get the cost. Is that clear?
Yes.
The pattern that I'm talking about. Mathematics is a science. A pattern of order. It has to be learned with an understanding. You don't have to memorize it. When you learn with an understanding, when you justify whatever that you are doing in mathematics, you develop an identity of mathematician. You will have a positive attitude towards it. As in, when you go to your exam, go with confidence that I'm going to it. Because this thing called mathematics, it makes sense. Whatever question you come across, don't worry about it. Just try to read with an understanding and try to check some concept embedded in that particular problem and try to figure it out. What does it mean? Start there. And thank you.
Yeah.
I think I must go back to hear me.
Yeah, I was thank you so much, Prof Machaba. I after matric, I decided no more maths in my life. But I'm intrigued to register maths 101 now. And you said it depends on who taught you.
Yeah.
And indeed, my teacher was not opening the lips when he was teaching maths in matric. And I told myself, I don't want to struggle again. But this was interesting. And I made an analogy for methodology of any subject as he was giving this pattern. I took it for lesson plan. The first one is conceptual understanding. And then I said, what is a lesson plan? I wanted to understand the concept. What is a lesson plan? Number two is procedural fluency. Then I said, here, the steps of a lesson plan. And this is for any methodology that you are doing as you're going to do teaching practice. The third one is strategic competence. Then I told myself, here, I'm going to ask myself, am I competent to teach the subject? Am I competent in the PCK, pedagogic content knowledge of English, of science, of biology, of life orientation? Then the fourth step is adaptive reasoning. Then I ask myself this question, why am I preparing a lesson before I go to class? You can't go to class and teach holding a textbook like this and then thinking that learners will understand you. No, but you must prepare before you go to class. Then the last step, productive disposition. Then here I said, planning a lesson before actual teaching makes sense. This is what I've learned for myself. And I think any student teacher must have these steps for any lesson plan and for any subject. This is working for any subject. Understand the concept of your subject.